हेलो, इट्स माय वॉइस ऑडिबल? हेलो, इज माय वॉइस ऑडिबल? ओके, लेट्स स्टार्ट अ सेशन. ओके, थैंक यू एवरीवन, एंड आई वेलकम यू फॉर दिस एफडीपी. एस डिस्कस्ड, द सेकेंड डे ऑफ दिस एफडीपी शेड्यूल टू हैव अ प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन सम न्यूरल नेटवर्क मॉडल्स दैट आर ट्रीटेड एज सैलो neural network model. So before going into the topic of today's session, let me give some discussion why I have given the today's topic as shallow neural network model. Before the term deep neural network model came into the academic research and industry community, and it is widespread over the many sectors, the models that we are going to discuss today are simply called as artificial neural network models. However, with the launch of those deep neural network models, I am in a position to say these models as shallow model. So before going into the topic, I think I have to refresh few topics or few highlights of yesterday morning presentation. So I am stopping the this screen and going back to the yesterday morning presentation screen. So yesterday morning session, before closing of the morning session, we have seen this model, that is basic ANN models, or otherwise it is called by the name primitive ANN model. So in this case, we have seen five different models: Mekula and Pitts model, Hef model, perceptron model, Adeline model, and Madeline model. For each model, we have discussed about the architecture, net input calculation, output calculation, and weight updation. At the end, we discussed about a problem called linear separability. So once again, I'm going to discuss those ideas. So what is linear separability is, if a data is given to you, say for example, in the illustrative example provided, OR gate and AND gate. So the data provided is the truth table of OR gate and AND gate. If you see the truth table of OR gate and AND gate, there are two input variables, X1 and X2, and one output variable, Y. Similarly for XOR gate also. And if you look at the output variable Y, you find two output classes, 0 and 1. When you draw a simple plot for the given data, then you find that by means of simple straight line, you can divide the set of input which is showing output 0 with the set of inputs which is showing 1 as output with respect to OR and AND gate. See, there is a strong bar straight line which divides the set of inputs which producing 0 in case of AND gate with 1. In case of OR gate, a straight line is there, slanting straight line is there, which it divides the set of input which is producing output Y as 0 with respect to the set of inputs which is producing output 1. But when coming to the case of OR gate, the situation is entirely different. That is, we cannot draw a simple linear straight line to divide the two different classes, 1 and 0. The line looks like something non-linear. So I finished yesterday presentation by saying that most of the data of real world problems are non-linear only. That is of this kind of nature. That is of the nature with respect to XOR gate. So if you want to use the basic primitive models to solve such kind of problems, then it is not easier for one to achieve good performance. That means those models suffers some weakness in providing good results for such kind of non-linear data. So I always say that whenever data complexity is increased, then the basic or the primitive model won't be a suitable one for your problem. So what is the complexity here? Linearity of the data is little bit increased to non-linearity of the data. In such situation, you are not in a position to use the primitive model, whereas you should go for the shallow neural network models. So let me go to the topic for shallow neural network models. Before that, we have content revisited in the yesterday closing session. In all the models, five models, basic models, what you have discussed is architecture and net input calculation, and more importantly, weight updation equation. Look at the Madeleine architecture. The weight updation is carried out in the hidden layer as well as in the output layer. And look at the architecture of the Madeleine. So what is the architecture of the Madeleine? Madeleine is having three-layered architecture. By physically, it is three-layered architecture, but computationally, it is a two-layered architecture. Why? Because the layer which is accepting the node X1, Xi, Xn are input nodes, which is not doing the activity of SOMA. If you say a node is doing the activity of SOMA, then it means it is doing two operations. One is summation operation, another one is activation operation. But in general, the first layer of nodes, which is treated as input layer nodes, doesn't do any activity. So here in the Madeleine, the middle layer, that is the hidden layer, is doing the activity of the SOMA, and the output is fed as input to the node which is present in the output layer. And in this output layer, the activity of the SOMA is performed, and we are going to receive the output. Now, the problem of nonlinearity arises very frequently in case of a data that is having more input variables. In Madeleine architecture, if you could see that the output node is only one node, that means this node can either produce zero or it produce one. So at any point of time, the number of classes that can be used in this particular architecture is two. That means it is a binary class architecture. That is, if you have a data, and in that data, if you have only two classes of nature, 0 and 1, or something else, 1 and 2 frequently. So if it has only two class labels, then this Madeleine architecture is suitable. Why? Because this two class nature of the data is somehow linearly separable. So this Madeleine architecture is very easily suited for such kind of task. But think about the problem having more number of output classes, for which an example may be, see, a fast face recognition system. We cannot say a two persons face recognition. We have to recognize n number of persons. Likewise, if you go for many real world problems, the number of classes available are more than two. So if you have a data set which is having more than two classes, and if you want to develop a machine learning algorithm with the help of neural network, then this basic model are not sufficient. So with respect to the data complexity, we are going to the somehow advanced models, and in this case, the advanced model are treated in the name shallow neural network model. So I hope you understand the reason why we are going for shallow neural network model. That is, whenever you have a data, and if the data is having more than two classes, that is multiple classes, then it is mandatory for one to use the shallow neural network model, provided the data is of numerical data in nature. So let me stop this presentation, that is yesterday presentation, and I will go to the another one that is today's presentation. I hope the screen is visible to you. So today's topic in the title shallow neural network model, I am going to discuss about three neural network model. One is backpropagation neural network. Another one is radial basis function network. And the last one is self-organizing future map. Among the three models, the backpropagation neural network model is widely used. So my focus of today's presentation is around that backpropagation neural network model. However, I will give little bit idea or little bit glimpse of idea into the radial basis function network model as well as the self-organizing future map model. So first, let me go into the first one, backpropagation neural network model. So look at the architecture. So just compare this architecture with the Madelain architecture. What is the change? So when you compare this neural network architecture with the Madelain architecture, what is the change? Here also, we have three layers: input layer, hidden layer, and output layer. In input layer also, we have n number of nodes. In hidden layer also, we have n number of nodes. In output layer also, we have n number of nodes. But what is the difference between the Madelain as well as this model? Yes, in this model, the number of nodes in the output layer is more than one. Look at the output layer. The number of nodes in the output layer is designated as y1, yk, and ym. So this means this particular architecture is very powerful enough to handle any data that is having more than two classes, that is multi-classes. Then look at the architecture. So the input layer, let me take a node x1. The node x1 is having connection to every other node in the hidden layer. So there is a connection from x1 to z1. There is a connection from x1 to zj. And there is a connection from x1 to zp. As I said, with respect to biological neuron, each connection is associated with a synapse, that is weight. X1 to Z1 is associated with the weight V11. X1 to Zj is associated with the weight V1j. X1 to Zp is associated with the weight V1p. So accordingly, the second stage of model is also having similar kind of connection. That is, what is the second stage? The stage is between hidden layer and the output layer. So in this stage, hidden layer is treated as an input layer and output layer is the output layer. So from Z1, the connection is going from Y1, YK, and YM. So for the connection between Z1 to Y1, the weight parameters are W11. For Z1 and YK, it is W1K. And for Z1 and YM, it is W1M. So there are some bias connections are available in this architecture. X0 is the bias connection from input layer to hidden layer, and Z0 are the bias connections from hidden layer to output layer. Look at the end, there are some values T1, etc. up to TK, etc. up to TM. They are not physical connection. Remember, they are not physical connection. Our architecture completes in the arrow, that is in the forward direction, Y1, YK, YM. Up to that, the architecture completes. Why I have used the arrow in that direction, T1, TK, TM is, it's to show you that once the network have produced the value Y1, YK, YM, then it is the duty to do a comparison between the Y1 and the T1. What is Y1? In the yesterday class, I said that Y1 is nothing but actual network output. T1 is nothing but target, that is actual output. So when some set of inputs is provided to the model, that is X1, XI, XN, then this XI, XN is fed into the network and some MA products is calculated in the layer hidden, Z1, Zj, Zp, and output is produced. And then it is going to the output layer Y1, YK, YM to produce small Y1, YK, YM. At the first level of feeding the input, this Y1, YK, YM definitely not matching with the target. So what you have to do is you have to calculate the error. That is the difference between T1 and Y1. Then this error is utilized to find the suitable values for the variables V as well as the variables W. Many variables of V are available between set of X's and a set of Z's, and many variables of W are available between set of Z and set of Y's. What are these variables are called? These variables are called weight variables. How to start the process of learning in this particular model? You should assign the input variable value X1, XI, XN. Then you should initialize the values for the variables V, all V's, as well as you should initialize the values for all W's to a random possible values. Now the calculation is carried out. According to the calculation that we discussed in the very first slide, that is SOMA calculation, then the output is produced. Then this output is compared with the target. Error is measured, and that error is used to update the values so that our objective is to minimize the error. That means our objective is to produce the correct output. So we start the random values of V and the random values of W, but over the period of time, we are going to attain a suitable and ideal value for V and W's. Let me explain. Let me explain the computation. First, take the node X1. Some value X1 is fed into the node X1. What is the duty of X1? It just passes the value X1 to the each Z1, Zj, Zp. Let us take the node Z1. X1 node's duty is just passing the value, whereas the Z1 node is the actual neuron. It does the activity of the neuron. What are the activities of neuron? One is summation, another one is activation. So here in X1, you divide the Z1 into 2. So what is calculated? First, net input is calculated, then activation is calculated. So in case of net input calculation, at the node Z1, how the values are? Where are the connections are from? The connections are from X1, XI, and XN. So Z1 net input is X1 into V11 plus XI into VI1 plus XN into VN1 with respect to the bias plus X0 into V01. So this is the total net input in the Z1. After that, what we have to apply? We have to apply some activation function. Once some activation function is applied to the Z1 in, that is f of Z1 in, that is net input of Z1. Over the net input of Z1, we have to apply an activation function f. If you apply activation function f, then what you got? You got Z1, that is the output of Z1. Likewise, Zj and Zp. Now this Z1, Zj, Zp is attached to or is fed as an input to Y1, YK, YM. Let me take the node YK here. So here YK, you have to do two calculation. One is summation, another one is activation. Take the node yk. So what are the net input calculation? First, let me take the bias z0 into w0k plus z1 into w1k plus zj into wjk plus zp and wpk. This is the net input calculation. Over the net input calculation, again, what you have to apply? Add some activation function is applied. Now, what is produced? Small yk is produced. And this small yk is the network output, that is output produced by the model. And this network output yk is compared with tk. That means some error value is calculated. And this error value, strictly speaking, in the first go, it won't be equal to one another, or the error is not ideal, the error is not closer to zero. It will be very higher value. So what you have to do? This error value is used. As discussed in the Adeline and Madeline model, this error value is used to update the V and W. That is, old weight value is equal to new weight value plus change in weight value. Old bias value is equal to new bias value plus change in bias value. So for which now the error is used in the backward direction to find the new values for W and V. See, remember, there is no backward connection, but instead, during the computation, once the error is calculated, and if you see the error is a bigger one, then this error is propagated in the backward direction. That means utilized back for updating the values of V and W. So for which, now at this stage, this input node, this output node Y1, YK, YM is simply acting as a layer that passing the input, Y1. Now, what is calculated here is del W is calculated. Net del W is calculated. Likewise, net WV is calculated. Here in this particular node, Z1. So this way, the weight values W and V is updated. Once the values are updated, then it is again fed back, calculated the error, fed back, again feed forward, again backward, weight updations are carried out. So this condition is carried out until Y1 is equivalent to T1, YK is equivalent to TK, and YM is equivalent to TM. In this way, the process is carried out. So let me explain once again this algorithm with the, in terms of some equations, that is backpropagation algorithm. To understand the backpropagation algorithm, so I divided the algorithm into three phases. Phase one is nothing but feed forward phase. Phase two is nothing but after calculation of error, backpropagation of error. Phase three is weight and bias updation. So under each phase, we need to calculate what is the value in the hidden unit, what is the value in the output unit. Let me take the first phase, that is feed forward phase. In the hidden unit, what is calculated? Net input is calculated. That is Z in J equal to VOJ, that is bias, plus summation I equal to 1 to N XI VIJ. I hope you now understood what is the meaning for this expression. Next output, how output is calculated? Over the Z in J, you have to apply a F. You have to apply a F. That is an activation function is applied to calculate ZJ. Next, come to the output unit. Output unit, Y in K, YK. YK, Y in K, net input. That is equal to WOK, that is bias, plus Z, summation J equal to 1 to P, ZK, ZJ, WJK. Then output, YK equal to F of Y in K. That is over the net input of the YKth node, activation function is applied to produce YK. So this is the phase one. That's what that I explained previous with respect to the previous slide. So until then, what is set to complete? The phase one is set to complete. That is output calculation in the hidden unit and output calculation in the output unit. Next is phase two. the output that is calculated in the output unit, that is the treated as network output, is compared with the actual output, that is a target, and error is calculated. See, in the output unit, error is calculated. That is dou k is calculated. Dou k is nothing but tk minus yk f dash of y in k. So this is the new thing introduced in the back propagation algorithm. That is the derivative of y in k. Then change in weight is calculated. Del wjk is equal to alpha into dou k zj. Change in bias at del wok equal to alpha into del k. So del k is calculated during the error calculation stage, and alpha is nothing but learning rate. Zj is the input of that particular node. Then in the hidden unit, what is calculated? Net delta input is calculated, because all the delta values are get accumulated in the node. So net delta input calculated, it is nothing but summation of k equal to 1 to m del k wjk. Then the error is calculated here also, because it is the, to find the value for v in j. So del vij and del voj is calculated with respect to the weights in the output unit. The weights in the hidden unit v is change in weight in the hidden unit is calculated, and it is nothing but dou j. What is dou j? Dou j is nothing but net delta input over which some activation function is applied in the Z in J to get the del J, dou J. Now, once the del WJK, del WOK, that is a del W, del VIJ, del VOJ is calculated, that is change in weight and bias is calculated, then it is the end of the phase two, that is back propagation of error. Now, what is the third phase? It is the phase that updates the weight and bias. So now, what is the weight and bias equation? Weight, new weight is equal to old weight plus change in weight del wjk. Likewise, in the hidden unit, new weight is equal to old weight plus del vij, that is change in bias. So now I think you hope understand the process of the back propagation algorithm. So what this three phase is illustrated in this slide is one single go, that means one single iteration, which comprises of feeding all the inputs of the data. And this one go that involves feeding of all the input data is treated as one epoch. Normally, the backpropagation algorithm won't stop in one epoch. It will take some n number of epochs to settle down. What is meant by settle down? So that means the network output should be equivalent to the actual output, that is target. So if that equivalent value is obtained, that means if the error value is near to zero, then you mean to settle down the iterative process of the back propagation algorithm. Until then, you should do all the three phases repeatedly for every data cases. So while doing so, at one point of time, you will end up with the value that you expected, that is, each network output y1, yk, ym should be equivalent to each target t1, tk, tm. This kind of approach is popularly called by the name gradient descent approach. Why it is called a gradient descent approach? Let us explain this via this graph. Imagine a neural network that consists of only two weights, w1 and w0. W1 is given in the x-axis, W naught is shown in the y axis, whereas the error is shown in the z axis. So W naught value ranges from positive value 2 to negative value minus 1. So W naught ranges from minus 1 to 2. W1 ranges from positive value 3 to negative value minus 2. So in the graph, it is displayed like that, whereas the error ranges from 0 to 25. So how to start, how we started the backpropagation, how we started the training process, we randomly initialize the value for W0 and W1. That means our initial weight value will be somewhere here in the two-dimensional space. If you drew a line corresponding to the W0, then W0 value will be something between 0 and 1. Say for example, if I drew a line here, then the value will be 0.3. Say for example, for W0. Likewise, if you draw a line vertically to the W1 plane, then I get the line may be between 1 and 0. That means it will be 0.9. So what is the initial value for W1? It is 0.9. What is the initial value for W0? It is 0.3. At that particular point, the minimum error up the at that particular point, sorry, at that particular point, the error is somewhere around 15. If you drew a line to a plane E of W, then the error is 15. Now, what is done? The weight values are updated with the focus of decreasing the error. Once the error is decreased, say for example, if the error value is decreased to a minimum value, that is more or less equivalent to zero. If you drew a line here, it is more or less equivalent to zero. At that time, what is the value of W0? W0 is minus 0.9 and W1 is 0.5. So this is the position, this is the point designating the minimum error value, and this is the point designating the maximum error, that is the for the initial weight and bias value. And at this point, you got a final weight value for W0 and W1. So this means that the backpropagation algorithm follows a gradient. As a gradient means weight, doesn't means degrees. A gradient is error, doesn't means degrees. So the weight values are updated with the focus of decreasing the error. So I hope you understand the process behind the backpropagation algorithm. Now, design parameters. To design this backpropagation algorithm, what are all the points you should remember? First of all, you need data. Once the data is provided, you need to think about how many number of data you are going to take for training, and how many number of data you are going to take for testing, what is the nature of training, and what is the network structure, weights and bias, learning rate and momentum, termination criteria. So all these points are needed before getting into designing the neural network model, that is especially a backpropagation neural network model. So let me discuss the point one by one. So whenever your data is given to you, the first task before developing the neural network model is divide the data into two sets, training and testing data. In general, some random division is carried out. However, some kind of intuitive partitioning is also possible. That means while dividing the data, more number of data has to be taken for training. And that means 1/3 of the data is utilized for testing, and the remaining portions are used for training. That is, the data may be divided in the ratio of 75% to 25%, or 60 to 40, or 50 to 50, likewise. So at no cost, the testing data should be more than the training data, because during the training process, we have to give as much as amount of data possible so that the network can learn your environment very well. Also, while dividing the data, there is a task that is performed. That task is called normalization. Why we need to do normalization is to suppress the value of the higher valued variable. I will explain this part in the practical class in the afternoon session. What is the normalization and why we have to use? Nature of training. So training is in training. What is meant by training? Giving the data, making the network to learn the data. Giving the data, making the network to learn the data. What do you mean by learn the data? Updating the weight according to the data. That's it. I have to give the data. The network has to learn the data. That means the network has to update the weight according to the data. So in what way I have to conduct the training? I can conduct the training in two different modes. One is pattern mode. Another one is batch mode. In pattern mode, every data pattern has to be presented, error is calculated, and weights are updated. That is, if your data contains 150 records, means each record you have to present, for each record you have to calculate error, and then for each error you have to update the weight value. That is called pattern mode. And what is meant by batch mode? In batch mode, data is given in one shot. How many number of data you have, no need to bother about the number of data you have. All the data will be given as input to the neural network model as one batch. For the error is calculated for the entire data, and then weight is updated over the entire data. So this is the way in which you will discuss about the patch mode of training. So there are two mode of training. One is pattern mode, another one is batch mode. This is the most important part of designing a neural network model, that is a selection of network structure. This is most and most important problem of deciding a neural network architecture for the data you have, because everyone is having their own data. Each data is of different kind. So based on the data only, you have to select the network structure. The first point you should remember is deciding the number of input nodes. So it generally depends on the problem, or simply speaking, it depends on the data you have. If your data have number of input variables, out of the input based on the number of input variable, you have to decide the number of input nodes. Coming to the output nodes, it also depends on the problem. So here one may say that likewise, like the number of input node, that depends on the number of input variables, we can also decide the number of output nodes based on the number of output variable. So it is not the case, because the output node of the neuron is always producing a probabilistic value. So we need not take the number of output nodes as par with the number of output values, but instead you can go for choosing the number output nodes in par with the output variable. If you have n number of output variable, then you can have n number of output nodes. But if you have n number of output values, then you should not go for n number of output nodes. But definitely it should be more than two output nodes in case of multi-class classification problem. But it depends on the way in which the values have been taken. I will explain this very clearly in the practical session. Then comes to the number of hidden layers. So strictly speaking, we are discussing about the shallow network model. So the number of hidden layers will be always one. There are some situations in which you can increase the number of hidden layers from single to many. In such a case, the network will become a multi-layer perceptron. Of course, this is the base for deep learning neural network, because in deep learning neural network, we have more number of layers, and all those layers are hidden layers between the input and the output layer. So if you increase the number of hidden layers, definitely the architecture will lead to a depth architecture, that means a deep learning architecture. But in deep learning, every hidden layer is doing a separate task, but that task is different from the number of hidden layers. If you increase here, each hidden layer is intended to do the similar kind of task when compared with the other hidden layers. But conceptually and computationally, if you increase the number of hidden layers here in this shallow model, is entirely different from that deep network models. So in shallow network model, it is good to start with single hidden layer. In case if you didn't get any expected output, then you may start increasing the hidden layer. But remember one thing, if you increase the number of hidden layer for the shallow neural network, so you have to, for focusing the accuracy alone, then what you got back is your network is more complex and the computation is more complex, and it will be taking more time. So that is the limitation, or that is the challenge that you face when you increase the number of hidden layers in the shallow network models. Then deciding the number of neurons in the hidden layer. So this is more ideal problem in any network model, especially deep as well as a shallow model. One, I have decided the hidden layer. I want to have only one hidden layer. If it is one hidden layer, then how many number of neurons have been taken? So this is a more and more trivial problem in case of selection of choosing the network structure for any neural network. In general, it depends on the problem. That is, it is not depending on the data, but it depends on the result that we are going to get for the problem. If you didn't get good results, then you start increasing the neuron of the hidden layer. Layer is one, but the number of nodes in the layer is maybe some 2 or 3 or 4 or even 10 or 100, whatever it may be, until you got a satisfactory or good results. So this kind of approach is called trial and error approach. Next, coming to the most important topic of this structure, that is activation function. See, each node's duty is summation and activation. Summation is simply a mathematical calculation, that is calculating the weighted sum, product of sum. But activation function is differing with respect to each type of function. So in general, the different kind of activation function used in different layers have different names. They are called by the name transfer function, or training function, learning function, performance function. Accordingly, the definition are. So the transfer function mostly used between output to calculate the net input. It is a tan sigmoidal function. The training function is Leverberg-Margorit function, train LM. The learning function is learning gradient descent method function. And the performance function is mean square error function. So these are all some commonly used activation function, where you can also choose some other activation function and check your results. Your results may have better, or it may be something different. So depending on the accuracy you got, you may either increase or you may decrease the number of hidden neurons, as well as depending on the accuracy you got, you may change the kind of activation function. The most important parameter, the weights and the bias. So what is the objective of ANN model? We are till now saying that training a neural network, or that means weight updating the model, updating the weight of neural network model. So that is the scenario. So whenever you say I am training a neural network model, it means I am finding the suitable values for weights and bias, because I know the input, I know the output. What I need to know to produce the output for the input, I need to know the weight value, because weight is the one that contains knowledge about the problem. So to solve any problem, we need to decide the weight value. In general, we do not know the weight value, so we start with the initial random values and we increase the weight values either in the positive side or in the negative side, depends on the target we achieve. So based on that, we will be processing the weights and bias value. So accordingly, the weights are represented in a matrix. What is W11? It is the weight between X1 and Z1. What is W12? It is the weight between X1 and Z2. What is the WNM? It is the weight between X1 and ZM. So the first two row of weight values are the weight values originating from the node X1. The second row of weight values are the weight values originating from X2. Likewise, the last row XN, weight values are WN1, WN2, etc. up to WNM. So it is represented as a matrix. Accordingly, the bias is also represented the weight value. So it is the one that has to be taken after the trained model and has to be embedded into the chip. And then you may say that the artificial neural network model embedded into the chip, that be embedded into any machine for making the machine to work smartly. So most important parameter in terms of making the backpropagation learning are two parameter, learning rate and momentum. So learning rate is represented by the symbol alpha, momentum is represented by the symbol eta. So learning rate chooses a value between 0.001 to 10, whereas momentum chooses a value between 0 and 1. Both the parameter are useful for making the neural network to converge very fastly. What is meant by converge? That is, what is our objective in making the neural network model training? Our objective is to make the network output equivalent to the actual output. So once the network output is equal to the actual output, then we said that the network is converged. At the point of convergence, we need to took away the weight values and the bias value, and that weight value and bias value is the knowledge. So for making the neural network model to converge faster, we use these two parameters, alpha and momentum. So alpha is the rate at which weight is updated. Eta is the amount of weight updated at each step. So at each step, you are updating the weight value. So at each step, how much amount of weight you have to update, that depends on the eta value. At each step, how fast the weight value is updated, that is depend on the alpha value. So these are the two parameter you have to remember. And finally, termination criteria, when I have to stop the algorithm training process or neural network training process. So one parameter is epoch that I said previously. So epoch is the number of iteration for a bulk of data presented to the network. Then another parameter is goal. What is goal? It is nothing but minimum acceptable error. So we are accepting the error to be zero. What is error? It is nothing but the difference between actual output and the target. We are accepting the expecting the error to be zero. However, there are certain situation we should not get zero exactly. It may be 0.0001 or 0.01 or 0.005, like that. So we have to set the value as a goal. Once the goal is reached, you have to stop the process. So in general, you need to do the training by having a motivation or by having a factor to achieve a balance between memorization and generalization, because it is a computer. If you keep on making the training process, the training will be happened continuously. If you do so, at one point of time, the neural network won't train itself. Instead, it start consuming the data. That is, it starts memorizing the data. But this case should not be there. Imagine a classroom approach. You are teaching a student. In a class, there are 60 students are available. You are expecting a good performance of all the 60 students. Instead of teaching the subject, you are making the student daily writing some important question, daily writing some important mathematical problems, keep on repeatedly doing the same task. Means at one point of time, the student will not think about a new situation. The student will not think about how to solve the new kind of problem. Instead, he solve only the existing problem. The same scenario is happened with respect to the mathematics class in school days. So they will be giving many problems and they are asking the student to solve the problems again and again, again and again, again and again, the same kind of problem, same set of problems. So the students have scored good marks in the school level mathematics without generalization, but by memorization, they have scored good marks in mathematics without generalization. And if you come to the first year of engineering, most of the students got failed in engineering course because they didn't generalize well. They are not in a position to understand what a mathematics is, how to approach a problem, in what procedure we have to tackle the problem. Those kind of steps are not available. That is, the student brain is forced to memorize the concept. So in such a way, in this artificial neural network model also, while you are going to give the training should be continued until the training gets saturated. That is, it reaches the goal or it reaches the epoch. If you keep on training the neural network above the goal or above the epoch, a predefined epoch, then what it does is the error decreases. At one point of time, the error start to increase. At that particular point, it means that your neural network start consuming the data point, that is start memorizing the data point, and your neural network doesn't generalize well for any unknown cases. That is, you should always achieve a balance between memorization and generalization. Whenever you thought that during the training, so this is sufficient. More than that, if you feel that your neural network will start memorize the data and it won't work for some unseen data during the testing time, then you should stop the process of training the neural network model. So this is another strategy you should follow for stopping the training the neural network model. So this is the another model. So with this, the widely used backpropagation neural network model is satisfactorily conveyed, and the design challenges are also conveyed. In the afternoon session, in the practical way, I will give you some demo, as well as I will ask you to write code. I will also explain the code, how to develop the backpropagation neural network model for any problem. So little bit idea about some other model. That is radial basis function network model. So if you look at the architecture of this network, it is also similar to the backpropagation neural network model. But what is the difference is here in the hidden layer, what activation function used is, it is radial basis function. So in this also, there is no weight connections here. So this particular neural network model is powerful in terms of speed when compared with the feed-forward neural network model. So with respect to the activation function, with the usage of radial basis as of activation function in the hidden layer, the radial basis function network differs from backpropagation network. Apart from that, all the things are common. That is, architecture is common, training algorithm is common. That is, we are forwarding the, it has a forward phase, backpropagation of error, and weight and bias updation. Only thing the activation function used is radial basis function. Accordingly, this is the structure of your radial basis. It is nothing but you need to calculate the, once your data is given, you have to randomly choose a center point from the data. And for each data value, you have to calculate the distance from the data point to the corresponding center. So that is the idea behind radial basis before getting into the hidden layer in the input layer. So some commonly used radial basis functions are given. So you can use any one of the function in the hidden layer, which is treated as a radial basis function network. What is the formula that is used for the net input calculation and output calculation? The net input calculation, see, in the net input calculation, in the output layer, summation I equal to 1 to k w vi of xi. What is vi of xi? So this is the new one with respect to RBFN or radial basis function network. So what is vi xi? Vi xi is nothing but output from the hidden layer unit. This output from the hidden layer unit is calculated with the help of radial basis function. And this is the expression for the radial basis function. Exponential minus summation I j equal to 1 to I. What is xij? Xij is each data pattern. What is xji? The neighboring data pattern. For each data pattern, that means a center. So for each data pattern, you have to calculate this value, and this value is utilized in the net input calculation of output layer, and over which as usual standard activation function is applied to produce the output. The major difference between these two neural networks, that is backpropagation neural network and RBFN neural network, is the usage of radial basis function as the activation function in the hidden layer and the production of output, which is treated as very faster when compared with the backpropagation neural network. The final model here is self-organizing future map. So this is a two-dimensional view of the model self-organizing future map. And this model is doing a task called clustering. So far, we have addressed the model backpropagation neural network model and radial basis function. They are very popular for doing two different tasks. One is classification in terms of discrete label. Another one is a prediction in terms of real values. And both are used for the task of classification and prediction. And both have used their learning algorithm called supervised learning algorithm. But this neural network model, self-organizing feature map, is using an unsupervised learning algorithm. And it is used for doing a task called future mapping or dimensionality reduction or clustering. So these are the important points dealing with the self-organizing feature map. If you look at this point, that is the specialty of this neural network model is topological preserving property of human brain. Yes, of course, it is the scientist Kohanen who studied this property. So Kohanen studied the topological preserving property of a human brain. What is mean by topological preserving property? Let me explain this with an example. If you all close your eyes and if we ask you to imagine a television, you all imagine a television that is maybe present in your home or you may seen in some other complexes. So what is the thing that come to your mind if you imagine a TV? Some rectangular like box with some screen and some kind of movies or songs or anything is played into it. So likewise, if we ask you to remember or ask you to dream about any animal, say for example lion, so you remember some kind. So the topology means the edge points of the proper edge point of the object is stored into your brain. So that is the topology. So the same behavior is studied by the Kohanan, and he is using that behavior to develop a model, and it is based on the unsupervised learning model. So what kind of learning here applied is, see, in the look at the last point, when differed from other artificial neural network, this neural the network applies a model called competitive learning with respect to as opposed to error correction. So we used a model called backpropagation learning, whose objective is to find the error. But here, some kind of competition is happened between the input units. And see the fourth point, which is we have to choose a particular input point which is treated as the winner. So that learning of this particular model is a little trickier. And of course, our objective of this FDP is focusing only on supervised learning with respect to the deep learning neural network model that we are going to see in the tomorrow's class. So I limit with this about this unsupervised learning model. Maybe in another occasion, I am in a position to say more about this model with a practical training in this model. So with this, I close the today's session. If you have any question, I think you can ask the question. I may be in a position to clear your doubts. You may raise your hands. I may give answer to your question. So do you have any question here? So what are the algorithms we learned today? The basics of backpropagation neural network. I think it will be more clear when I give you a practical training using MATLAB software in the afternoon session. So if no more question is there, I think with this, I close the session. Thank you for your patient listening. And I ask the organizer of the FDP, if they want to say anything to the participants. Yes, one question is, one participant is raising the hand for asking the question. I will answer the question. Yes, ma'am. Samim Fatima, please ask your question.
Hello.
Yes.
Good morning, sir. Is the
I think your voice is very breaking.
What possible extent can we use the self-organizing maybe for our research, sir? Most probably we are all, but seeing this SOF. Hello, sir. Possible applications.
Yes.
We are actually clustering. Most of the time clustering. The neural network we are selecting. The training and testing we are using with RBF and some other neural applications.
Yes.
And we are probably taking this SOM, sir. So yes. Here, what is the very appreciable application related to SOM, sir?
So you can go for clustering. That means whenever you feel that your data is very huge, and if you feel that the huge data is not at all needed for the analysis, and if you want to cut down the data, that is, if you want to reduce the data so that effective data analysis can be conducted, so in such a scenario you can go for SOAP.
Okay,
dimensional reduction. Your data is very huge, that means your data contains n number of variables, and if you feel that all n number of variables are not sufficient or not good or not suitable for analysis, and if you want to reduce the number of variables to a reasonable level, so in such a case, you can go for dimensionality reduction, or you can go for clustering. using this SOAM model. I will give one case study in the afternoon session so that you can understand a little better.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Vinod, do you have any points to the audience? You please convey so that we will end the meeting. Is it okay?
Sir, no.
Okay.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful presentation.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, Ravind.
Is it audible, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Are you audible, sir?
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir, my research work is on leaf disease. Identification and diagnosis.
Yes.
So, which algorithm, the step of algorithm I can use to do this?
Yes. For the past 2 days, we are listening to some neural network models.
Yes. Yes.
These neural network models are popularly and widely used for some kind of numerical data. Even though I am saying that it is good for patterns, in the form of image or in the form of speech or any signals. But strictly speaking, these models suffers from some kind of weakness when you give image or signal or audio or speech. So in such a case, how to use a model that is deep learning model that we are going to discuss in the tomorrow class. So okay. Whatever the model discussed so far won't be good for your problem. So the deep learning model, either that is a CNN, convolutional neural network, will be a good one for your problem. Hmm. But why I taught these models are, well, to understand so this
CNN, letters, only CNN.
Yeah, yes. CNN is the ideal choice for your problem. Hello. Hello. Are you hearing me?
Sir, I think he is disconnected, sir. Ravindra Johar.
Okay. Okay. So.
Sir, one more.
Yes, Manjula.
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, good morning, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, madam.
Sir, I understand well your lecture, sir, and I have one doubt.
Yes,
sir,
ma'am.
You said that topological preserves the preserves the edges of the object. You said that, no, sir.
So,
sir, whether
no.
It can be.
Yes, tell me, ma'am.
Sir, it can be used to detect the human edges, sir, because I am working on detect the moving object like a human or any animal like that. I am working on that, sir.
Yes, ma'am. This SOAM model is a very simplified model. Just I explained the topological preserving property. What is mean by topological preserving property is similar to edge detection. See, if you imagine any object by closing your eyes, that object comes into your picture, right?
Yes, sir.
So in what way the object is coming into a picture? The borders, the usages, the image that you've seen last. So everything is coming into the picture. So that property is called topological preserving property. And that property is studied here. And some kind of algorithm is developed. So this is a simple SOAM model. I don't think so. This simple SOAM model will be good for edge detection. Maybe before edge detection, if you want to do any future extraction, or if you want to reduce any dimension, then this SOAM model is good.
Okay, sir.
So you can go for some hybrid model. See, there is one research that I will discuss in the afternoon session in which the backpropagation model is combined with the SOAM. Hybrid SOAM and BPN model. So you can combine this model with some other model. based on the problem that you have. So okay. I am not saying that it is not suitable. It's not exactly not suitable. It may be suitable, but you also think about the other hybrid model to be accompanied with SOAM model. Because to my knowledge, I understood that SOAM is popularly used for dimensionality reduction, that is reducing the dimension.
Okay, sir. After the dimension reduction, we can find out the features, then we can identify the right object, right object.
Yeah, yeah, yes, so, yes, ma'am.
It can be used like this, sir.
Yeah,
sir,
yes,
and due to some network issue, I could not follow that delta is used for error. Then alpha is used for something you said, but I could not able to understand.
Both alpha and eta are used to make the training faster.
Okay, sir.
So what is conducted during training? Weight updation is conducted during training.
Yes, sir.
So that means you need to update the weight in a faster manner. Faster convergence means faster way of updating the weights.
Okay.
So that means alpha is used to fix the rate at which weight is updated, the rate of updating the weight with respect to time. Each 5 minutes you have to update the weight, or each 1 minute you have to update the weight, or each 3 minutes you have to update the weight. That is learning rate. Learning rate. And what is eta? Momentum is amount of weight I have to update. For each 1 minute, if you update the weight, means for each 1 minute, I have to update the weight in terms of 5 or in terms of 10 or in terms of 20. So it is with respect to the weight value. Momentum is with respect to weight value, and alpha is with respect to time.
Okay.
So both are meant for fast updating of weights, so that the termination is very faster.
Okay.
Otherwise, I can say that convergence is very, very faster. What is convergence? Error is approximately zero. What is error?
Minimized.
It is the difference between it is the difference between target and the network output.
Network output. Okay.
I hope I answered.
Yes, sir. Understood, sir. And how long we can give back propagation, sir, until it reaches the epoch?
Yes, ma'am.
How long? You
can have two parameters. One thing you can focus on epoch, or another thing you can focus on goal. So normally you focus on goal, ma'am. Compared to epoch, you focus on goal. Because when you focus only on epoch, then there can arise a situation of memorization.
Yes, so
focus on goal. That is the ideal scenario.
Okay, sir. If it memorized, it won't give the right results when we give the some new
test data.
Test data. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, if possible, will you send the recorded lecture, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Sure. The organizer will send the recorded lecture. I will also recording the lecture here. I will send it to the organizer. The organizer will in turn send to you.
Okay, sir. Okay. Due to some network problems, sir, yesterday morning itself, I have some problems, so I could not able to follow your session, sir.
Okay, ma'am. The same thank network problem I am also facing. I am worrying about whether my lecture will be...
But you learned a lot. But now I am learning.
Okay, ma'am.
You
okay,
have a network problem, no problem. Thank you, sir.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So I think it is time up. We shall stop the process.
Yes, sir. We will end the meeting, and all the participants will receive the link soon for the afternoon session through mail or through WhatsApp. Okay. Sir, okay, sir. Thank you, sir. We will end
thank
the
you.
Session, sir.
Thank you.